So welcome everyone to the joint session of GG Ahmedabad, GG Pune. Today's session is about learning about Nearpod and using Nearpod in day-to-day education and remote teaching learning. Today's our session expert is Murtuza Sinarwala from UAE, and he's an expert. He's a LEGO certified trainer, teacher trainer, and he has got many more achievements. Murtuza, kindly introduce yourself. I mean, though people know you, but just introduce yourself and then we can start the session. Over to you, Murtuza.
Hello everyone. Thank you for joining. Happy New Year to everyone. I'm based in the UAE. I'm a level 1, level 2 Google educator. Been working with Google tools from a couple of years. And thank you for joining us in today's session. Today is Nearpod and creating active engagement with Nearpod. I can speak Gujarati, so agar koine aim hoy ke English mari fast ya accent is not correct, मैंने गुजराती में अभी पूछी सको छो इवन मराठी बट आई मे नॉट रिस्पॉन्ड इन मराठी बट आई कैन अंडरस्टैंड ओके सो लेट्स गेट स्टार्टेड सो वी आर ऑल अवेयर ऑफ ऑल द गूगल टूल्स एंड इट्स द गूगल सूट एंड द कॉम्बिनेशन ऑफ टूल्स इज क्वाइट अ पावरफुल इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर ऑन इट्स ओन ओके वॉट Nearpod डज इज gets a lot of these tools together. Okay, now we use polls everywhere or Mentimeter to create polls. We use Google Jamboard for collaborative work. Okay, but what happens is many times these different tools make it very difficult for the teacher to conduct a classroom. Okay, what Nearpod does is it tries to get a lot of these tools into a single umbrella, okay, and also it integrates very well with your Google Slides as well as Google Classroom. Okay, now it has two major components. One is your content part and one is your formative assessment part. Okay, before I move in, if there are two very similar tools, both of them work really well with Google. One is Nearpod and the other is PeerDeck. If someone is already using PeerDeck, don't switch. That's a great tool on its own. It's very similar. I would say there's a 90% overlap between PeerDeck and Nearpod. Both have its advantages and both have a little bit of differences in them. Okay, so let's get started. I'll jump directly into the Nearpod session. Okay, so what I want you to do is go on your browser, go to join Nearpod, search for join Nearpod, click on the link nearpod.com/student, okay, and enter the code magic. Okay, take a couple of minutes, enter the code magic and just have a look at what do you see. So before I walk through with you on the different features of Nearpod, I want you to, we'll take it's 8:40, we take 5 minutes and I just want you to observe the magic Nearpod which pops in. If possible, have your phone or a second device next to you. That will really help you to be connected to the meet as well as join Nearpod in the future. If you have a second device, if not, just open up a second tab next to your Google Meet and have a look at it. If you have any questions, you could use the raise hand feature at the bottom or just type it in the chat box.
Yes, Murtuza, we have already tested the magic code and it's working very well.
Okay. Just I want everyone to observe the whole experience, okay, on their own. just go through it on your own, have a look at it. It's around 6 to 7 slides there.
Slides.
Yeah, very nice. A lot of information and a lot of different things that can be done.
This is brilliant. All in one go.
I had gone through the presentation before, so I know the answers. Still, I made a mistake.
Okay. This is really good.
So, there are 24 participants, and for many of you, it would be the first time to actually see Nearpod. Okay.
Yes.
What was your experience? If you can, if anyone could, if you have to say one word about what you saw in the magic Nearpod, what would be that? What was that one thing which really amazed you?
It's a complete solution.
It's a complete solution.
Yeah. Interactive, balls, VR, and. It's a complete solution. Really appreciate that.
So let's just dive a little deeper into Nearpod. Okay, anywhere when you are into Nearpod and you want to make any notes, you can see this notes icon at the on the right. So if you click on it, that would open up a sidebar which will allow you to write your notes at the bottom, and then you can save your notes back in Nearpod. So let's dive into a Nearpod session itself. Okay. So now with Nearpod, you can use two different ways to participate in Nearpod. Okay. We call this by words synchronous learning and asynchronous learning. Okay. Asynchronous learning is something which we do live with the students. Okay. It could be on video during with the students, or just like how we did right now, where I was there as a facilitator, but you were doing your own activity. So that's the synchronous part. A student-based part is something where you have been left, you have been given an activity, and you've been left to continue on your own pace. Okay. So with Nearpod, you can work with both these methods. Okay? We look at one by one. So we'll go with live participation first. So as soon as I would start the live participation lesson of this is a pre-prepared Nearpod lesson which I'll go through. So as soon as it starts, it should show you a code, a 6-digit code, which a 5-digit code which you can put it on your second device. So if you have a second device, just put this code. Go to join.nearpod.com. And just put this code. If you have it as an app on your phone, use that that link. Put that into the chat box. It's 248WZ. have Kushal, Ms. Mukta, Ms. Vaishma already joined.
Hello. Excuse me, Murtuza, Priya.
Yeah, Priya.
You have to install it on the mobile or?
You can install, there's an app which you can install it on a mobile, or you can just open up a Chrome browser from your phone and go to join.nearpod.com and put the code 248WZ.
Okay, okay. So from the browser also it will work, right?
Yeah, it will work from the browser.
Yeah, okay, okay, yeah.
Now, as teachers over here, you can hide the students' names. Okay, so if you do not want to show the list of the students, if you just click on hide student name, it will just hide the student's name from the participants there. Okay, right now you are seeing the whole screen as a teacher view. Okay? If you go right on the top, I can switch to students' view. So as a teacher, I have control to see how it appears for me as a teacher or how it appears to me as a student. You'd be able to when you would have put the code, this was the screen which would appear to you to put your name there. We have 8 people. I'll wait for a minute for the others to join.
Murtaza, till then we have a question. Amarjit wants to ask that this code, does it work only when the teacher has opened the lesson or it will work afterwards also?
So if I would exit this lesson, since this is a live participation, it will not work afterwards. But if it's a student-based one, it will work afterwards. But if I exit the lesson and I want to continue, if my class is say, I finished my time and I want to continue the same class, the code again after a week, it would allow me to restart the code. So let me just show it to you right now. So if I would go back, okay, it shows you can leave the session and you can resume it later. Okay.
Okay.
Since right now people are joining in, I'll not do this, but then I can show you that you can leave it and then you can again restart this with the same code.
Okay. Thanks.
Any other questions?
So just as we added our name, after we added the code, we asked for the name, and now it is showing us just the welcome screen. It says that please wait for the teacher to start the lesson.
Yes, because this is a live participation. So as a student, you are allowed. You will not be able to move the screen or play. Go to the next slides. Okay.
And for so this, do we have to create an account with Nearpod, or we can just start?
You can just start directly without an account. If you create an account with Nearpod, it will allow you to have the access of all the features. So as teachers, I would recommend that you have an account, okay? And if you're going to use Nearpod regularly in your classroom, it's better to have an account with Nearpod.
And just like, I know, out of curiosity, just like it's a Google Classroom, is Nearpod free available for the teachers, or is it having some licenses?
It does have some licenses. So there are 4 kinds of different licenses. You have a free account, which will give you limited features for Nearpod. Then you have a district license, and then you have a school-wide license.
Okay.
So these are the 4 different licenses which I have. Right now, currently, I'm on a paid account or district account which I have.
Okay. Okay.
So now we have around 12 participants. Let's carry on with the session. Okay. those who were, who missed it, the code is still available on the top left, so you can have a look at it. So as I mentioned about the notes, let's take a quick overview of what is Nearpod. So Nearpod is a presentation tool with a lot of add-ons to it. Okay. Now it helps you to create more interactive lessons and videos, okay, and make the whole class more engaging. As I mentioned, there are two major components of a Nearpod lesson. One is the content part, and then the other is the formative assessment part. So there are there were nine. Now there are 11 different ways where you can do formative assessments. And on the content part, you can add videos, slides, online content. So you can directly import, say, your Google Slides directly inside Nearpod and then add interactives to it. Okay. It also has third-party add-ons like FET simulation, which science teachers may be aware of. They are science lab simulations which are there. Then there's Desmos, which is for maths, for graphing. Okay. And then there is Microsoft Sway application, which is like very similar to Google Sites. Okay. From the activity side, Time to Climb is a gamified version of Kahoot, very similar to Kahoot. Then you have open-ended questions, which is where you enter the question and wait for students' replies. Matching pair, this is great for primary schools where you have to it's match the following, which we call them. Quiz is common. Flipgrid is again a tool where you can ask the students to have video assessments and upload it over here. Drawit is basically very similar to Google Jamboard. Collaborative is very similar to Padlet. Okay. Poll is again like polls everywhere, Mentimeter. Fill in the blanks, as the name says, we use in our answer sheets. Memory test is it's a match match the cards game kind of thing. So you have a grid and you have to match the cards based on the memories of when it opens and closes. You know, we used to play it with playing cards in my childhood. And then audio recorder, which is asking students to record their understanding and assessments. So these are the different ways you can include Nearpod in your classroom. Okay, let's take, I'll just quickly play this video from Nearpod.
Introducing Nearpod. With Nearpod, you can make every lesson interactive.
Not sure, did I start presenting with audio?
It was
with audio. Yeah, we can hear it, yeah.
Oh, okay. Sorry.
Launch lessons your students can't wait to join with collaborative engagement. With Nearpod, you can make every lesson interactive. Launch lessons your students can't wait to join with collaborative, engaging activities like virtual reality, simulation, and gamified quizzes. As the teacher, you'll always know where your students are with Nearpod's formative assessments, including polls, open-ended questions, drawings, and more.
Introducing Nearpod.
What you already have. Upload any of your favorite resources, PowerPoints, Google Slides, and videos, including directly from YouTube. Then add in media and formative assessment in a few clicks. And now you can add questions directly into videos to make them interactive. Get started even faster with our library of pre-made lessons and videos, built in partnership with some of your favorite brands. You can use them as is or customize to meet the unique needs of your students. Once you're ready to launch your lesson, choose from three teaching modes. In live participation mode, you control the pace and students participate on their devices, either in person or remotely with web conferencing. In student-paced mode, students move through and participate on their own, whether they're working from home or in class working in centers, stations, or groups. With front-of-class mode, you can use Nearpod without student devices and facilitate collaborative discussions. Imagine what you can do with Nearpod. Your students will love lessons that combine engaging media with collaborative ways for them to show off how much they've learned. You'll love unlocking student understanding in real time and having reports to inform the next day's instruction. You'll wonder how you taught without it. Learn more and get started for free at Nearpod.com.
Brilliant.
One of the things is, if I had not presented the started the video, since you were already, all of you were in the class, you could actually see the whole video from your own device itself. Okay, that's another one way to have the students watch the video on their own pace there. Okay, a collaborative board is what's one of the features from assignments.
Sorry, Murtuza, to interrupt, but when you were showing the presentation, since we had joined the class, ideally we should have been able to see on our devices, right? But it didn't happen. I could see only on the laptop here.
There was a play button at the bottom, which where we could start playing the video.
Okay, but it's not like when you start sharing, I should see. Is it that way?
No, it's not.
It's self-paced.
It's self-paced.
It's self-paced. Okay.
Yeah. It's self-paced. The video will work on your, when you start playing on your device. Only the slides will be in the control right now.
Okay.
Live participation.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
So now I've started a collaborative board. Okay. This is one of the features of Nearpod. Okay. I would like you to share what's your New Year resolution for teaching for 2021. Okay, so I know I've seen one person, Dr. Vishal Warrior has put a post. And if you can see on my screen, I have an option to verify the post and then I can enter it. And I can see Swati has also posted a post. So you could see that coming. Okay, now the other students can go and, okay, that's give it a like there. So it could also be as a voting tool inside the classroom.
So Murtaza, can the students see who wrote it?
I don't think we are able to see who has wrote it. The teacher is able to see.
Only the teacher can see the names.
Yes, so that is the beauty of it, I think.
Right now, you cannot see the names of the students, because if you see my screen at the bottom, I've seen written hide student's name. Okay, the moment I click show student name, that should now start showing you the student's name off on the post itself.
I think we should wait till it shows something. It is not yet showing the name.
Sorry. It was showing the name when I was, so it, for you it will not show. For me, it was showing the names on my screen. Now, when I clicked on hide student's name, then now you can see the names are not visible on my screen.
Okay.
They come with an asterisk.
Okay. So it is only for the teacher, not for the student.
It's only for the teacher, yes.
Okay.
So if I click on show student name, there it would show me the names of the students which have posted the comments below. Okay. And as a teacher, I could say,
really appreciate this collaborative tool. Easy for students to write.
Yeah, this is just one way of a collaborative tool. Okay, if you want to have, say you are presenting, you are teaching in a class, and you suddenly come up with a collaborative tool discussion, all you can do is, you can see on the top there is an option called Add Activity. Okay, so when I click on Add Activity, I could then have these five options also come up with. Okay, so if I am in a classroom and I say, okay, how to get GG certified, and I want to show the web, I want to pull the web content at the same time, I can click on web content. If there is an open-ended question which I want to add in, I can add it there itself, or a drawing tool from the actor on the same activity itself. Okay, so let's look at some more tools. Okay, now this on my screen right now, you can see that there is a Google slide which I've embedded right inside the Nearpod itself. Okay, so you will see that's a Google slide, and I completely embedded inside the Nearpod, and I can then move along with the Google slide. So you can you don't need to rework your whole Google slide back into Nearpod. Now, one thing which is not available is you cannot copy paste Google Nearpod slides into Google Sites or vice versa. So the only way is to embed it inside the Nearpod itself. Okay, but you can also create your Nearpod inside Google Slides. Okay, so if I go to my Google slides for a moment, okay, and if I go on add-ons, okay, you'll see I have added on something called as Nearpod add-on. Okay, if you do not have it on your add-on right now, you can go to manage add-ons and search for Nearpod. Okay, so when I say Nearpod add-on, and if I click add-on over here, you'd see a bar of Nearpod which appears on the right. Okay. Now this will allow you to add Nearpod content right inside Google's slide itself. Okay. So if I want to add a collaborative board, I can add a collaborative board and add it inside Google Slides. So you, if you're happy working only with Google Slides, you can use that and then save it the whole of your Google Slides back to Nearpod.
So it's a reversible connection with Google Slides. You can have a Google Slide into the Nearpod, and you can have Nearpod into the Google Slide. And when you are having an add-on in the Google Slide, still, you can easily access the same thing in the Nearpod.
Yes, true. So if I would add a best feature, okay, and then I could choose the theme. Let's see. So let's say that I just. Sorry?
Yeah, sorry. In this case, if we are just adding an add-on to the Google Slide, and then we are using, you know, when we are taking everything back to Nearpod, then would it appear in our ID that we created in Nearpod?
Yes, or it will appear
in the same ID. Nearpod.
Yeah, so because you can see I've logged in with the same ID at the bottom, so it will appear with the same ID. Okay. So if, when I say save and go to Nearpod, that will convert it to a Nearpod
So it's important that when you create a Nearpod ID, you should have the same ID as you have a Google ID. So you can can exchange seamlessly.
Yeah,
that's great.
Okay. Now, let's look at what is a student paced lesson. So now if I would exit this and the same lesson, if I would go open up. So it just takes a minute for it to load. So let's take another lesson. Say let's take, we're talking about COVID virus and vaccines. So if I would take one of that lessons, okay. So now you see, the 5-digit code, okay, and you see that it's valid from a date for almost 30 days, okay. And the other option which you have here is it requires students' responses to prevent skipping. So if you have a quiz or a question or a poll, it will not allow the students to skip the answers and move to the next slides. Okay. If I would switch that on, that would go. And once now you can exit the previous code and try out this Nearpod on student page. So now this one you will be able to move towards to the next slide on your own from your device.
Murtaza, do you mind sharing the link directly in the chat?
Sure, I'll do that.
So those who are using the another tab, we can just click on that link. Perfect. So should we just close the earlier one?
Yeah, you just exit from that. You just have a join a session and enter the new code.
Okay.
Really appreciate Murtaza. Your sessions are quite interactive. And we definitely learn a lot from this. And this is what we as an educator have to make ensure that our sessions on remote teaching learning platform needs to be interactive. So that students.
Yeah, and I really feel that seeing what students do is also very important, because we can figure out the tool ourselves, but we don't know how the students react to it.
Yes.
So the other part of Nearpod, which is really helpful, is the reports. Okay. So a lot of data is actually being collected by Nearpods in terms of quiz, in terms of the polls, time is climb and all. But how, as educators, we use the data to use it for scaffolding, differentiation, and to change our approach to teaching is important. Now, when I showed you activities that you can add collaborative boards and questions on the fly, how do you take the answers and responses from the students to make sure that has the concept been understood by the students, or do you need to spend more time to it? Okay, so that's where Nearpod reports come into play. Okay. So I can see there are 9 students who have joined in this Nearpod. Okay. And not sure if any of you would have. So this is all about what are different vaccines, the Pfizer vaccine and the Moderna vaccine, which is there. In Dubai, they have already rolled out to 100,000 people the vaccine. And there's a web content which talks about how the vaccine works. Okay, but if I go to reports, I will be getting a report of how the participants would have answered the questions there. So, say for example. I want you to still continue and answer a few questions. From the vaccine presentation. In the meanwhile, I will open up the reports tab to show you how the reports look like.
Murtaza, there is a question who says that for logging into Nearpod, we need a school email.
No, I'm using a personal email. So, I have purchased the license of Nearpod on a personal email. So that works as well. It does not need a school email. But ideally, if your school is going with Nearpod and they are purchasing a plan, then you can have it so that it works on the same domain which is there, and then you can it has advanced features which the IT administrators could work, that the data remains secure in the inside your school or your district, as well as the single sign-on option which is available with Google or Microsoft. So if you're using it inside your classroom, then it's better you have that on your school email address.
This is really good because,
So now I've opened up the report section of Nearpod. Okay, now just to show you back from where did I get it. So under on my left hand side, just under my library, you have the report option. And if I would have run this session, this class multiple times with different sections, then it will show you a different number of session names there. Okay, so there were 10 students, and 3 of the students have answered it right now. And you can see the engagement details from all the students over here. So I think Priya has
so glad we are all at 0%.
Yeah, because you still have to answer a couple of questions.
Great.
Okay.
So I can see Priya has answered the part and I think the part the collaborative board part. Yeah, sorry, someone was asking.
On one of the slides, it says that click the green button to write the text.
Yeah. So it takes you to your web content. Basically, it talks to you about the whole presentation of how the virus works. So the green button is actually the begin button at the bottom of that content itself.
Oh, okay. Because my screen did not show any green button, so I can just click on the text and start writing, right?
That is, yeah.
Okay.
Now, I would have got an email with a whole detailed report per student on the engagement level. So that's how I would know how my class has been engaging and how they are answering each and every question. And then I could help that particular class or the students to participate and help them in the concept there.
This particular presentation, have you prepared it or have you got it from any resource?
I got it from Nearpod. Yeah. So now that was my next part of Nearpod, that you have a lot of good library content. So more than there are around 500 or more lessons which are available by Nearpod itself. Okay. So if you go to Nearpod library, the easiest way to get started with Nearpod is actually going and looking at the library. Okay, so even if you're not planning to use Nearpod on a regular level, I would still encourage you to actually go into Nearpod and have a look at different lessons available over here. Okay, now you have lessons by premium teachers who write lessons just for Nearpod. Then you have lessons by different partners like BBC. Or National Geographic puts in the lessons. So you could search by grade or by subject. So if I look at science, grade 7, that would filter out lessons for me, and then I could have that over here. Okay. It also has all the videos available from BBC and National Geographic available inside Nearpod itself.
So you just simply select it and get it on your ID.
Yeah. So for example, I want to take I took the COVID-19 vaccine from here, but let's say I want to take Endangered Species Act. Okay, I would just click on that. Say add to library, and then once it's in my library, I could then edit it as per my convenient over here. So I can see at the bottom, it shows me add to library. Once I click on add to library, that would be available inside my library over here. So one of the easiest way, and I think that's more than enough to actually reuse a particular content and then just modify the way it works for you in your classroom.
True.
I had a question that are there any resources available with a free account, or we always have to, the teachers will have to buy the account Nearpod license?
I think there are lessons available from the free account. So there are a couple of lessons, I think around 50 to 80 lessons, which are available on the free account. I'm not 100% sure.
So the teachers can start using and exploring it, and then also they can buy the license.
So they can still create a Nearpod with a free account. They may not be able to integrate it with Google Slides or Google Classroom, but on the Nearpod, they can still create a few free Nearpod with a limited number of slides available.
Okay.
But they can still see the Nearpod content from different topics. I think only the vocabulary, which is the vocabulary part of Nearpod, that's a premium one which may not be available.
Okay.
So now if you can see that lesson on endangered species is added, and I can just go to edit part and I can say edit the lesson. And if you have say multiple classrooms and you want a different version for multiple students or multiple classrooms, you can always duplicate a particular part of lesson. So over here you have the lesson outline, and then you can add your own slides or add your own content to this part.
Okay. So do
search the topics which you are actually teaching and have a look at what the other teachers and what is an exemplary lesson available on Nearpod. That really helps you to get started with Nearpod, know how to ask open-ended questions on the topic, how to use more engagement with drawing for that topic itself. So these are tips and tricks which you can actually collect from Nearpod and then reuse it on your own itself.
So
yes, sir. Someone was asking a question.
There was a question earlier which I would like to take it right now. I also have the same question. I think Nearpod also has got some certification for teachers.
Yep, there is a Nearpod certified educator which is there. So it's a Google form which you have to fill up, where you have to have create your own lesson, upload it up on the Google form, and explain your storyline and your vision behind that lesson. That's mostly it which you have to. Once it's approved with all the components of using all the components of Nearpod, then they give you a certified educator level. I think there's only one level.
Okay.
Now let's actually go and create one lesson. So just to give you that confidence, how easy it is to create a lesson. Okay. So if I go on my lessons and I go and click on lessons. Okay. That would open up the page where I could then keep adding slides. Okay. So if I click on add slides, as I mentioned, there are two parts, the actual content part and then the activities part. Okay. So you could add a video, web content, a Nearpod 3D. So if I would add Nearpod 3D, that would open up the whole library of 3D clips and videos, which you can then simply add into Nearpod. Okay. Say, for example, if I would take Animal Cell, take a preview of how that 3D image would look like. And then add it to Nearpod. Okay. Similarly with BBC videos and all. So what I encourage the teachers is actually to go and use each and click on each and every part of the Nearpod and actually see how it works. Okay. There's nothing which is going to go wrong or break in Nearpod. So just go and click on each and every part and just explore the different available tools which are there. So for example, let's take something which is very uncommon, is using memory test. Okay. So it opens up a grid. Okay. I could search, say,
Thank you.
this is the Mammoth game which is there.
So if we take up these logos, they will not have any copyright issues.
No, it does a Google Safe Search.
Okay.
So all the images, when you click on adding an image, I'll also show that part. So it does do a Google Safe Search for you in your part. Okay. Now if I go on next. So maybe this is the logo.
So did it just identify the correct logo?
No, I choose on the logo which I wanted to be the right logo. So
okay.
Which is the
most, it's a quiz. It's a quiz.
Logo. Okay. So it's a match. Okay. Matching game. As well as it asked a question at the end. Okay, just to give you a preview of that. So it would open up. I don't know if you would have played this card game at the when you, I used to play it with playing cards or Uno. Just takes a minute. And this is great for primary students now. If you have to match vocabulary with images or phonic sounds with images, so it would open up this, and then I would have to click on the okay. That was a wild guess. Okay.
This is brilliant and engaging.
So I have to find out.
It is fun for students also. Like they are playing, but they are actually learning.
Yeah, exactly.
Gamification.
There you go. Okay, so this is one of them, and all the tools have their own purpose for formative assessment. Some of them work really well for secondary schools. Some of them really work for primary. Okay, you can also embed a Google form in it, and you can also embed it inside a Google Classroom. Okay, but I don't want to go very details in all the technicality over here. My best tools are Time to Climb, Matching Pairs for younger ones, or Time to Climb, Matching Pairs, and Memory Test for primary students. Draw It, collaborative board polls for secondary students. Okay, if I really wanted to do a quiz, I would still stick to Google Form separately to do a quiz activity if it's not related to that particular test, or I want to do it as an after the lesson formative assessment, which is there. Let's go back. There are a couple of more features which are there. Sometimes you have to have a substitute teacher, or no, you fall sick and someone else is going to take up your lesson. They have an option which is called sub plans. Basically, this is what you do is you create a sub plan and you add it. So you create a new sub plan. You tell them, okay, you're on sick leave or an emergency leave. And then you create, okay, these are the three Nearpods, one after the other, the students have to do. And then you can hand it over to your co-teacher who is going to take your substitute class. A very fancy feature. Some teachers appreciate that, especially for primary when you're co-teaching with an assistant teacher.
This is the solution. That's great.
So that's more of more than what I was planning to cover today. Things are very pretty simple with Nearpod. Again, my best tip: look at the pre-existing Nearpod lessons rather than creating your own. There are really great tons of good lesson ideas from all subject, computer science, maths, language. I think language is the most strongest in Nearpod in terms of activities. And if you take Google Classroom and you can add, if you add the Nearpod add-on to it, so you can then make a Nearpod assignment itself
In the classroom itself, yeah.
Or you take the code and you paste it, you take the self live participation or the self-paced code and you put it inside the Google Classroom link or stream. So these are the two ways you can add it inside for Google Classroom. So I'll take some questions.
There is a quick question, Murtaza. How to add this add-on in the classroom?
Okay.
Yeah,
I'll just. So, it's you just go to the add-on market space. I'll just show that. So any add-on which you want to add for any Google tools, just go to Google. We go to Google add-on market space and you can add it from there itself.
Okay. It's just like, just as you, you know, add this 35M or Autocrat, the similar way you add an earphone.
Yep.
Okay. So it's basically an extension.
Yeah, it's an extension add-on. For the other ones, usually you have an add-on drop-down directly inside that particular tool. But for Classroom, you have to go through this add-on option over here.
I need to get it done for my school. Great.
Any other questions?
Yeah. I got this. Yeah. This is how we add this. Yeah. That's fine. Thanks.
Oh. Any particular tool or
part? Again, there is a quick question, Murtaza. Can you please show how it can be useful to computer science?
Okay. So I'll go to the Nearpod library. Just a minute. So it does have lessons based on computer science available. So if you go to technology and computer science, and I could say select grades 8.
Brilliant.
So these are the different lessons available on computer science.
Brilliant. This is great, Murtaza. And it's really interesting and it's really insightful and it's engaging. We need to dig deeper into this Nearpod concept and it could go on and on.
There is a
yeah, yes, Murtaza.
There's a lot in Nearpod and it's something like, you know, when you have to cook, you have two options. You can go and buy the different ingredients and make biryani on your own, or you just buy that Shan masala packet and then just make biryani. So Nearpod is something like that with all the tools together.
Yes.
Including the ready-made recipes.
Yeah. The Shan masala packet, yeah, we'll get it.
Murtaza, we understand it's dinner time. So
Murtaza must be in the process of making biryani now.
But Murtaza, it was an excellent session. Like you showed us everything from teacher angle. You showed us everything from students angle. And I think now educators know at least a basic of it, and now they have to start exploring. Like you said, namak kitna dale ya tikha kitna banaye, it is up to the teacher.
True, very true.
Then it becomes very then what I expect is just to give you the whole flavor of what Nearpod is, and then you go and click on each and every button and find out what it does. That's the best way to learn. Okay.
Great. So I'll just do a quick note for everyone. I've just pasted the feedback form link. Kindly please fill it up and fetch your certificate for Nearpod. Yes, Murtaza, please continue.
The biggest advantage of using Google Nearpod to just include only using Google Slides or anything else is actually the reports, okay, which I do not look a lot detail because of the less data which we had collected, okay. But that's something which really motivated me to look at Nearpod, because I could see what each and every student would have answered. Even though it's not a live class, when we are doing remote learning, we are giving the students the chance to answer it on their own pace. But actually looking at this data and understanding how my teaching was, how engaging it was, and how much they answered. So that's something which is really, really powerful tool. And I would like you to actually make a Nearpod, use it in a classroom, and look at what the report option is.
Brilliant, brilliant. So much to learn, and much did we learn from this session, Murtaza. We got to know maximum of the Nearpod thing from this session, and it's worth trying. What do you say, Rishma?
Yeah, absolutely. That is what I was thinking, because I also did the Edpuzzle coach thing. So when you yourself try to click all the things and try to create your own lesson, you learn a lot. So yes. Murtaza gave us a nice overview of what it is. And I think now every teacher, and we all should, even I will try, I have never used Nearpod, but I will try to create one lesson completely myself. So I'm confident what I'm doing, and then I will go pick lessons from the project.
Yes.
Whenever it is there.
So I would suggest Krishma do the other way. Pick up a lesson from the projects itself, and then add your own tweak to it. Okay.
Okay.
Also has the so if you do not see, one of the things with Nearpod is, as I mentioned, it has a lot of things in one umbrella. So if anyone of you have not heard about Edpuzzle and you want to see, Nearpod has that option too, to make your own Edpuzzle kind of activities. So if instead of lessons, if you go to videos, you can add any video and then create your own Edpuzzle kind of interaction, which is there.
Very nice, very nice. Yeah, it was a great session, Murtaza, and you have always been very resourceful for all the educators.
Yes, so obviously.
On that quick note, those who are here, I will put it up on our WhatsApp group also, that we were planning a session for tomorrow for add-on and extensions, but we will have to postpone it. So there will be no session tomorrow. We thought it is like too much one after another. So we need to give time to our family and other activities also.
Sure.
So
sure.
It's a weekend. So we will have our next session next Saturday, and we'll send all the details. Me or Dr. Varia will keep posting.
Yes, yes. So I think that's all for this session. Thanks, Murtaza, for this very insightful session for Nearpod. And we learned a lot. We got inspired and we got motivated to work with Nearpod. You really demonstrated it very rightly, properly. And I think all the educators would give it a try. And so that's it for today's session. I already shared the feedback link, feedback form link, kindly fill it up, and please be sure to enter your email addresses correctly in the feedback form so that you receive the certificate, because many times I do receive the bounce back of the emails, but then I can't do anything of it. So kindly spare some time before you fill up everything in the form, especially your email address. So that's all for today's session. We conclude today's meeting, and for today's session with Murtaza, three cheers for Murtaza, just as we do in our school. Team Tali Kaman, 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. So thanks again, Murtaza. Thank you very much for this very wonderful session of yours. And I'm just stopping this session for the record. And we can then conclude the session. You can leave the meeting.